Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
Hey, what's going on, guys? This is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV, YouTube channel for dog lovers. If you guys haven't already, you got to go ahead and subscribe to the channel. Today, we're doing another Let's Talk. These videos are opportunities for me to bring you guys into the conversation and talk seriously about dogs, not just, you know, consume the content, but interact with the content. I've been bringing on special guests, folks that I've dealt with, I met in the dog world, serious people that I think are valuable for you guys to hear and talk to them and interact with them. Today I have Mr. European Doberman Stud himself, Gerald Antoine, is in the building. I made a mistake, Gerald.
What's going on?
Still working out the kinks of this. Boom, that's what I want to do right there. I'm doing good, my brother. How you doing, man?
I'm doing spectacular, man. Glad everybody's had your family.
Everyone's doing wonderful over here, man. Everyone's doing wonderful. So you are in the history of in Dogumentary TV, I believe you are the very first person I interviewed about the Doberman Pinscher.
Right.
Yeah, so I think that was I think we maybe did one or two videos early, but I know all your videos have been rather successful on my channel. I know you're passionate about the breed. So for those who haven't had the opportunity to see the videos yet, give them a little bit of background about who you are and how you come to be associated with the Doberman Pinscher, the European Doberman Pinscher specifically.
Right. Well, my name is Gerald Antoine again, and you know, I'm from humble beginnings. I'm from Jackson, Mississippi. So everything was all about manual labor, hard work, and it pays off. There was never a helicopter ride or elevator ride to the top. I had to work my way up there. So growing up, I've always had an affinity for animals. You know, I used to watch the black and white channel. It was called Mutual of Omaha, where you have these old guys wrestling pythons in the Sahara and the savannah and the swamp deserts and all that stuff. And I've always been amazed by animals, because in Mississippi, we don't have a plethora of different type of animals that we can just study. So with that being said, you know, I think I had my first, we speed up the process. I had my first touch of having a dog. First of all, I couldn't have a dog growing up. My grandmother then would always say there's enough two-legged dogs in the house, so we couldn't have dogs at all. Fast forward, after I got out of college, had a little life started. In 2010, I went through depression, and I lived in a condo. I still had that condo, but I lived in a condo, and I wanted a large breed dog because I was a large guy, but I didn't want a hairy large breed dog. Because I don't like all that extra rolling and every day of your life. You know, you got the blonde hair or the black hair or the golden hair. And so I decided to do my research. So I said, the Doberman should be like ideal for me. It's short haired, it's active, it's codependent, and they can cohabitate inside of a home. And my first dog was a dog named Roos. Got him from a local breeder here in LA, and the dog was nice, but I was going training with Lewis Williams, a black mass, and I noticed that my dog wasn't acting a fool over the ball or the rag. So I'm like, why is he not doing that? So I did my research, come to find out he was 100% show line Doberman and not a working line Doberman, because drive is something genetic. You can't make him have drive. You can encourage him to have drive, but if he doesn't have it, he don't have it. So it was a doctor named Dr. Bill Relliford. He's a podiatrist that was training with Lewis, had a black European imported named Musa. And as soon as I saw Musa, I saw how Lewis had him on point, how the drive was. It was phenomenal. He was very energetic and hyper over every toy, over everything he pulled out that the dog could find himself enthralled by. And I said, I want that. I tried to contact Dr. Bill Relliford. He was so busy traveling, I did my own research. And then I found a breeder out in Hungary. So my first European dog was Alonzo in 2010. The game changed. In 90 days, when he was shipped to me, imported to me, I took him to Lewis. I let Lewis evaluate him. He said, I got something. And from that point, I knew that, because I knew what I wanted visually, but I didn't know what to look for as far as the intangibles. I didn't know how to do temperament testing or prey drive testing or anything like that. So I made a mistake on the first one. The second one, I hit a home run, in-park home run. And from that point on, it was, he got me out of the house. He got me out of depression. He kept me active. When nobody was there, he was there for me. And I was like, you know what? I know this breed. I'm sticking with it. Now, are there other breeds that I do love, like the Rottweiler? Yeah. The giant Russian Schnauzer? Yeah. But I don't know what I'm looking for with what particular breeders. So I kind of stay in my own lane. And from that point, it's been a passion. You know, I used to collect cars. I'm a G-body guy because I grew up in the 80s. And I get more out of dogs than I do cars. I get something back. I get affection. I get love. I don't get that from a car. And for me, it's you know, what's funny is, man, is that growing up, I used to see people cry about when their animals die. I was like, why are they crying? It's like, it's a dog. It's a cat. But until you had one, they're not just a pet. They're part of the family. You know, so now I get it. So with me, it's like, this is a super duper passion where I'm able to provide something to people to bring joy in their life. You know, I've had some high-end clients that have been able to get dogs off of me, and they do exactly what they're designed for, to work, you know, working line. And so, you know, for me, it's like, I'm a wealth of information. I got a lot of followers on Instagram. They've always asked me questions, and if I have time to answer those, depending on if they're legitimate questions or not, I reply with alacrity. And I get excited when I talk about it, because it's like, you know, my ex-wife told me a long time ago, this is when we was going through the divorce. So I don't know if she was saying it or not because we were going through the divorce, but she said that my dogs defy me. And I was like taken back. I was like, I thought about it. I said, you know what? I take that. My dog, I take that. Because, you know, we are in the Bible, it said we are the keepers of the beast. So I take that.
Right,
so,
right.
You know, from that point on, you know, just it, I'm still learning. And when I learn, I teach to the people who listen. If I don't know something, I'm going to ask. So it's just, it's a beautiful thing, man. Animals, man, give you something, man. Money just can't buy, man.
Right. You know. And that's the beautiful thing. I'm learning from doing Dogumentary TV, man, that there's always something to learn about dogs. It's, you know, you never know everything. It's not, you know, it's not a okay, I'm done. I know everything there is to know, right? And if you live with dogs, you're going to learn things about that dog. So they definitely are like a living, they definitely are a living, interactive educational source of education. But talk to me. I know your thing is you're more than just a Doberman guy. You're a working Doberman guy. And you're not just a working Doberman guy. You're a working Doberman guy who sources or believes in European Dobermans.
Correct.
So talk about how do we get so specific in our approach to the breed?
Well, I mean, to me, Zeke, you know, we're both college grads. We both went to HBCUs, right? You went to Howard, I went to Jackson State. And the one thing that no man on this planet can take from us is that you can suspend our driver license, you can suspend our practice, you can take our freedom, but you can never suspend our degree. You can't take that. Once we earned it, it's ours.
Right, that's right.
Right? So for me, when a dog, first of all, when I do history checks on dogs, I gotta see that both parents, because a lot of people get caught up on what the father doing. No, I wanna know what the mama doing too, because most puppies inherently take after the mother, right? So for me, I have to get a dog that is have both parents have working titles. And I'm gonna go full circle with that college degree and it goes to titles. So to me, when I advertise a litter for a breeder that I've sired, the selling point is that not only my dog is health tested, but he's titled. A dog that's being titled shows the amount of pressure he can take, his temperament, and his ability. Anybody can breed two beautiful dogs, and guess what? Make beautiful puppies. But are they scared of their own shadow? Do they have environmental issues? And some of these things are genetic. So for me, all of my males that I have in my camp, they have to be working towards getting titled in a protection sport. And those protection sports right now that I've been dealing with for the past 10 years is either, it used to be called IPO, but now it's called IGP, and French ring sport. And I may get into PSA working with Sykes over there at South Bay Malinois, but they gotta be titled to be in my camp because I got cats, I got pets. My dogs have to contribute to the household and they have to be of substance. And so when a dog has a title, to me, that's his degree. You can't take that from him. Once he earned it, he earned it. A lot of people, I'm not gonna say everybody and all because there's no such thing as that. But some people say, oh yeah, he's got drive. But how do we know that's not defense? How do we know that that's because he's frightened or scared? I wanna see a dog work under pressure. And protection sports done by good trainers and good handlers proves to me how to evaluate my dog's temperament and his ability. And this is nothing no different that the Europeans do over there when they're doing the ZTP confirmation. They measuring height, temperament, stability, confirmation, all that. Over here in the United States, dogs don't have to be titled to have a litter through AKC. But I'm trying to quasi mimic the Europeans' requirements to set a standard. Because when people get Dobermans, you know what you're getting. You don't go out and buy a Corvette and hope it's a V6 engine in there. You buy a Corvette because it's designed to go fast. You buy Dobermans because they were genetically designed to be a personal protector. I'm going to give you what you want. Now, I can't guarantee nothing because Jesus make the last decision on these puppies. But I sure in the heck try to make the best breeding possible with the best females when I match them up. And I think that's what set me and my camp apart is that I don't breed to just any female. I breed to certain females, not only for health purposes, temperaments, but their bloodline has to be on point. Because a lot of people are doing European Doberman pups, Zeke, and they're selling it off the first name, European. But in my captions, I always put the first word. It's an adjective, working.
Right.
That sets them apart. Now, whether you want to do luring, dock diving, barn hunting, PSA, PDC, Mondio, Brevet, my dog should have the preset DNA to be able to do one of those sports. Now, it's not guaranteed, but I'd rather have more than none. So that's how I stick with the working, and they got to be pretty looking, but you got to be able to, you know, take your gloves off too.
Right. So why specifically do you source all your males? Most of your males come from Europe, right?
All of them are imported, every one of them.
Right. Why do you import?
Good question. I'm going to say it in a professional way because this is a family channel. A few breeders that I've dealt with out here that I've tried to consider buying from, they want to put restrictions on you. Restriction number one, they give you limited AKC. Well, why give me limited? You're not going to take them to the vet. You know, dogs go to the vet more than me and you go to the hospital. You're not going to feed him. You're not, when he poops wrong, guess what? We go on to the vet. When he doesn't wake up good, we go on to the vet. When he's not acting right, you go on to the vet. You're not contributing to none of that. So why should I be beholden to you to be able to breed to my dog when he's of age and of within policies through AKC, right? So for me, it's like the reputable breeders will only give you limited until you get the dog title. Now, you know, and I know to get a dog title, whether it's the CGC, through AKC, whatever sport, it takes money and time. And sometimes there's an age limit. With IPO, got to be 16 months old first, right? Then two, some breeders out there, they don't breed for workability. And if they do breed for workability, it's going to come at a heavy price. You're looking at $3,500. Well, hell, for $3,500, I can import something from actual champions. I don't, not the grandparents. Me and you have different, we have different races in our bloodline, right? I'm Creole, so that, you know, so I'm a part of the Louisiana Purchase experiment, right? I don't look like my great-grandfather. So I don't care what my great-grandfather did. I want to know what the parents are doing. Are they titled, tested, and proven? So I find myself importing from actual working champions versus here where they put restrictions, the breeders, not all, but some, put restrictions on what you can do with the registration. And I don't like that, because by the time you're done, man, you spent $10,000 in training, vet care within a two-year period, man. I mean, easily. And they didn't put in 1% of that. So, no, I don't want to have to keep coming back to you. You may pass, you may die or something. And I got to, no, give me all what I want right now. I pay you up, I'm done. When I pay for my Prius, I get the pink slip, I'm done. I don't want to deal with that. Well, you got to pay a tax to Toyota every year. No, I'm done with this. The breeders here, it's really hard to find one that, and what's funny is about that is that some of these breeders, they put these restrictions on you and they don't even have it on their dog. Their dog's not even titled.
Right.
Their dogs haven't had their hips and elbows OFA certified, but they're telling you, you got to do it to get the full registration.
Right.
That's not fair.
Right. Now, I agree with half of what you're saying. I understand why breeders do that, though. That's because, you know, for most part, we got a lot of people out here that love to have, who have no experience, that just want to breed dogs, want to take something and flip it into a part-time job or extra income. But I think in your case, you know, someone who has a track record of producing dogs, titling and testing dogs and having, you know, full participation, you have a footprint within the community. I can understand why you would be upset with not getting breeding rights or being able to, you know, just basically purchase your breeding rights. People know what you're going to, should know. Right now you have a track record, they should know what you're going to do with your dog. When I bought my dog, I paid extra to get the breeding rights for the simple fact that not that I intend to breed him, it's just that he's my dog and I don't need no one coming back to me telling me what I'm going to do, or they need to, oh, well, you know, Zig, I gave you a deal on the dog and I think I want to pull some straws from your boy, you know, now that you done, like you said, now that you done fed him and got him to a nice healthy size and weight and all this other stuff. We know his hips are good and all this.
Yeah.
Why don't you start, you know, or you done made him famous on YouTube and we want, you know, some people want some puppies off of them. So I didn't want that issue. So I simply just said, look, I'm going ahead and let me know what it's going to cost. There was an extra, you know, it was a little extra money, but it was worth it. Now, you know, I walk the house, it's my dog. No one tells me what to do with him, where he's going, how he's going to get there and all that. But for most of the people out there in the crowd or in the show, somebody, oh, I hate that, you know, I think before you start, you know, concerning yourself with the breeding rights, you really need to establish yourself within a breed or establish yourself as a reputable dog owner and have some kind of track record so that when you're talking to a breeder, you have some sort of credibility to speak to, as opposed to just someone coming with a bunch of money saying, look, I want, you know, give me a male and a female and I'm going to take them out of here.
Yeah.
You know, so that's that. I know I saw a question, a couple people were asking about DCM. So let's talk about the health and wellness of the current Doberman Pinscher. Are you finding the dogs coming out of Europe are healthier, less genetic? Is there better genetic screening over Europe? Or, you know.
That's a good question. That's a real good question. When I first started importing about 10, 11 years ago now, they didn't screen that much. And when you buy a pup from them, they just didn't list the health at all. And so us Americans are so enamored about the looks, we overlook the health part. Like, why is it not listed? You got all these working titles. You got these puppy titles, best to go. And so I'll forget about it. I import them anyway. And then when you get the test done, it's like, he's got one, he's got three and four copies of this and that. You're like, what does this mean? So they've gotten when it comes to DCM, they've gotten 100% better. Well, I say 95% better. But VWD is always going to be out there in the European line, but it doesn't mutate to the next stage. So when a dog is a VW von Willebrand disease carrier, he will always stay a carrier. He won't develop into an infected dog. Well, a dog that's VWD clear will never develop into a DCM carrier. Now, you can have a dog that's DCM1, and this new test that came out 3-4 years ago, DCM2, he can be negative, but then he can have a spontaneous mutation. So you don't know. Right. So yeah, the breeders are advertising the parents are DCM1 negative, yeah. But the pups may develop DCM in 5 or 6 years. And that's something you just can't control. You can't control it. So for me, it's I try to breed for the DCM, you know, the stands for the diluted cardiomyopathy, DM, degenerative myopathy, VWD, von Willebrand disease. And then I get the hips OFA certified when they turn two. Because I don't waste my money on getting hips pre-certified, because dogs are still growing. And the European males typically grow sometimes up until 18 months old. You know, so it's, those are the best ones. But then you can do this Hollister, I think it's Halter test, every year, every 2 years, where they, it checks to see if the dog is a potential carrier for DCM, or DCM 1 and 2. But I've noticed that most of the dogs who die, Dobermans, they die from stupidity, like swallow something wrong, got hit by a car, attacked by a dog, developed, it's called contortion, I think, something like that. I may be mispronouncing it, where the dog drinks a lot of water and then go out there and run full speed and twist his stomach. So it's always freak accidents, but luckily none of my dogs have passed away from DCM or VWD. You know, Alonzo was put down recently because he had kidney cancer.
Okay.
He lived a good 10 years. So I could take that. He gave me 10 years, right. You know. But as far as those genetic mutated things, the Europeans have gotten a lot better with it. Yeah, they have. Because they know that basically we Americans are the one that's overpaying for these dogs, because over there in Europe, they're paying average pricing. But here, they know that the American dollar's weak. We got to pay extra. And they can tell us whatever price they want.
Right.
There's some breeders over there charging $5,000-$6,000 for their dogs. I don't think they'll get that over there in Germany.
Right.
Because it's like, hey, man, you come a dime a dozen around here.
Right.
But we are enamored with the looks, man. We get caught up on the looks.
Right. All right, well, what I want to do now, I'm going to open this up because, like I said, I didn't want this to run too long. And if you guys are aware, if you guys saw the schedule, I have another show coming on at 6:30 with Oscar Moore. He's a dog trainer out here in Southern California. But what I want to do is I want to open this up to the audience. If you guys are watching this video and you have a question, you want to talk to Mr. Antoine about the Doberman Pinscher, his breed of choice, you can call into the show. Just click the link in the description. And you will be doing a video call into the show. Now, understanding if you video call in here, your image and your likeness, your voice, all that stuff will be streamed across the world via my YouTube channel. All right? So if you guys want to call in and talk to Gerald, here's your chance. What are you doing right now, Gerald, with your dogs? We did a video a little while ago, the bad boys. We had my puppy and your puppy. Sigmund out of Russia. How's he doing right now?
Yo, Sigmund is doing good. He would have had, that's another thing we got to learn too. Don't do dog parks. Sigmund was, he's still training with Al, Ben Wallace. He was a former national IPO champion.
Al Venuelos.
That's right.
Yep.
And 2 weeks before trial, a dude had his Caney Corso off leash in a park. And you know, most dudes who have dogs like that don't have control over it.
Right.
So he attacked Sigmund. Sigmund had to have like 3 or 4 stitches in his hind leg, so he had to miss trial. But they got trial next month here in Compton. In June 22nd, he'll be going for his BH, and hopefully within the next month, he'll be going for his IGP-1, and then I'm going to bring him home.
Okay.
So he's doing pretty good. I rescued another dog named Bo. Previous owner said it was too much for him. Bo's going for his brevet right now. So I got a few things cooking.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, man. Well, that's what's up, man. Sigmund was a beautiful boy, man. I tell people all the time, yeah, part of what this channel is about is really like, you know, I do videos on powerful dog breeds, and I really want people to understand there's a lot of detail and minutiae that goes into owning a dog, right? It's not, like you said, we get caught up on the looks, right? I got this bad dog, you know, and he's this and he's that, and you think, you know, he listens to you around the house, in the house. But we got to start to understand that these dogs... they live in things, right? And that's why I said there's always something to learn. You know, there's always, you always got, I have Roscoe, and he's going to be 2 in a little bit. I'm always looking at him to figure out what does that mean? What is he about to do?
Yeah.
What's the next thing? What's he thinking about? Because I always got to step in front of him, like both mentally and physically. Sometimes I got to stand between him and trouble. The other day I was coming out the house, and he was just weird, you know? Like, I was like, what's going on with this dude? I'm going to take him right into the car, but I couldn't figure out what's going on with him. But for some reason, the way he was acting around the door, like usually he understands, like when it's time to go to the door, you sit down and you wait till I open the door. I should be able to step through the door and you come after me, right?
Yeah.
And so usually sometimes I can walk him to the car without putting him on a leash. I really have a little bit of slack of leash. I don't worry about it so much. I'm not worried.
Right.
But for some reason, I'm walking out the house, and every time I touch the door, he's running into the door. I'm like, dude, calm down, sit, you know, wait. But every time I touch the door, he's running into the door. And I was like, what the going on? You know what I'm saying? So I give him a nice little correction, and then I put him on the leash, open the door wide open, walk him back 3 steps, get out in front of him, and I start walking. And he goes out in front of me again. So I'm like, dude, what is going on? Which I'm getting a little upset, you know, got him on the leash and all this other stuff. Anyway, I get outside my house in the middle of the street. It's a big old coyote. And he lit up on it. And the thing about it is, this is what I'm saying. Like, you know, Roscoe barks, he defends the house. He's barking at a lot of things. Sometimes he's barking at people. Sometimes he's barking at possums. Sometimes he's barking at raccoons. And obviously, sometimes he's barking at coyotes. I don't see him because I'm in the backyard. I'm in the house. I don't see him.
He knows
it. He's aware of him, right? So, you know, but like I said, like if I'm in everyday mode, right? And I'm just thinking like, oh, I don't need to have him on a leash. I walk him through the door all the time. I ain't got to pay attention to this. You know, this is what we do. This is how we do it. That's what I'm saying. You always got to be thinking and be out in front of your dog. Because you got to know what your dog is doing. I literally could have had a dog fight, a dog and coyote fight in my front yard if I had just felt like, if I wasn't aware of his body language, you know what I'm saying? So
that goes so true because I got Casanova who's 9.5 months. I imported him too, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I was away, but when I got back, Stephanie was telling me that he was going off in the backyard. And I'm like, going off of who? All the neighbors. He knows the neighbors, right? He thought he was going off, like, acting a fool back there.
Right, right.
She goes out there, and it's a damn possum.
Yeah.
Playing dead. Because, you know, they play dead.
Yeah.
And so they know, man. And it's like, because in Carson, too, now, there's some coyotes by that golf stadium. I mean, by that golf course.
Right.
And so They just know, man, it's different. That's why, man, I love this animal. I love this breed. I just love animals, period, man. I think they symbolically they do something to us and for us that we just can't get from other humans, no matter what.
Right.
You know. And so I'm just blessed that I can be a part of this ride, you know, where I can enjoy something that gives me something back.
Right.
And I'm willing to share it, man. Willing to share it.
Yeah. All right. So we got a call coming in real quick. I just got another super chat. I don't know who that is, though. Let me go. Give me one second. I want to be thankful for everybody that's doing a super chat. That's Alexandra, the Tibetan Master. For some reason, you didn't pop up on my interface, bro, so I can't shout you out via the screen. But thank you, Alexandra. Oh, there you go right there. I'm sorry. There we go. Boom. Thank you so much for that. I appreciate it. It's a pretty dog you got there, too. I got a guest in a green room. It's Southwestern Ohio something. I can't remember the whole name that's coming across. Let's bring him into the conversation. What's going on, my man? How's it going?
Hey, what's up, brothers? Peace.
Peace.
What's going on?
Chilling.
Peace. Enjoying the knowledge, man. I love what you're doing, man.
Thanks a lot, man. I appreciate
it. I just came on, so I don't know the guest's name. I came on a little late, but the brother got some knowledge, too. I appreciate the knowledge, brothers.
Yeah, that's Gerald Antoine.
Gerald, okay. Man.
Gerald, yeah.
Okay, nice to meet you, man. But you too, bro. Basically, my question was, you know, I've been in the breeding game for a couple years. 25 to be exact, not to tell you my real age, but, I was dealing with, like, importing dogs. I had a import dog from Russia, a Corso. It wasn't the dog that was proposed to be sent to me. And then I had another mishap where, hold on one second, man.
It's a dog show. They're supposed to be barking.
Don't worry about that. Yeah, go ahead and talk. See what you got to say, bro. We listen to dogs bark all day, every day. It's not a thing.
Okay. No, I was saying, basically, you know, I'm just having problems importing dogs, man, getting good deals, you know, not getting scammed, and far as getting quality that I was wanting, you know what I'm saying? So my main question is, do you guys have some type of transportation, import, export outlet that you deal with, or is it like certain, things to look at when you're looking for breeders? To know if they're legit or if, you know, you're going to actually get the dog over. And, you know, the actual transporters that's going to charge you a good price. You know, who do you deal with, or is it some type of lane, you know? Just some knowledge you can give me so I won't get scammed on my money.
Hey, right, I'm going to let Daryl answer that question. Thank you for the call, all right?
All right, thanks.
Thank you, man.
That's a good question. So, When it comes to importing, it's been proven that the breeders over there are never going to send you their best. They're never going to send you their best or send you the one you think is the best, right? They're going to send you what they think is the best for you, which is typically sometimes not their best or their second best. He's like, he said, Kenny Corso's, right? Oscar Moore is a great... from Elevated Canines, a great resource for that particular breed. He imports too. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to importing, one thing you gotta remember, you gotta have a connection with somebody. You just can't go off of photos, because I guarantee you, somebody gonna take that same dog, they took 100 photos, and that one photo makes the dog look great, right? You don't get videos, you don't get nothing. So you need to go off a referral based by somebody that you trust. And Oscar would be a good person to ask that. You guys can search him on Instagram, Elevated Canine.
Or you can stick around. He's going to be here in about...
Yeah. Stick around. You'll get Oscar
20 minutes. Yeah. But we're going to be talking dog training. But go ahead.
Yeah. But another thing, in regards to shipping, that's the only thing that you're going to be handcuffed to, because they hold the golden ticket. And if it's being imported, it's going to have to ship via air. So unfortunately, I think my man's issues is that when it costs $900 for flights, that's really $1,300-$1,400 in euros, which is blowing up the price. But see, the American dollar is weaker, so you are held hog-tied in regards to the shipping cost. But to once you get the quality of dog that you want, you won't think about the shipping cost, because the dog's quality is going to supersede whatever price you paid. So you need to go by referral and somebody trusted, and not by some website with no resource or recourse. I got a main connect to a guy in Russia who's been connecting me for many years, and he won't let nobody. He's the godfather of Dobermans over there. As a matter of fact, I was supposed to go over there late part of last year, but the EU locked up and they wouldn't let us go see the Doberman dog show. They have the protection and obedience during that time at the Seeger show.
Seeger show.
And I was supposed to go, and they canceled it. And he invited me. So you got to get with a trusted person that knows the breed and look out for. Other than that, you may get a bag of rocks, bro.
All right, cool. I got another call for you. This is Josie. How's it going, Josie?
Hey.
Hi there. I'm going to let you see my little girl. She's 3, but she's camera shy. She's getting her head on the floor here. Anyway, she's a mix. She's a American Doberman and a European Doberman.
Okay.
Okay.
And the problem I had with her breeder, I got her out of Hollister, Missouri. I live up here in Wisconsin, Northwest Wisconsin. But anyway, I got her because he was the only one on the AKC breeder list that had a chocolate red Doberman. She is literally a chocolate color. She's just gorgeous and as sweet as can be. Her parents, I've got 5 generations back on both of them. I've got a male too. Now he's a purebred European, and he's got the height and he's got the dark coloring. Come here, show your face. Yeah, he's dark colored. The question I have for you, they're both not fixed, okay? Now, we're on our sixth, because my girl is 3 years old, sixth heat cycle. And this is the first time that he's acted differently. Okay. He's never showed any interest in her until this one. And because she is like, her parents, both of her parents were small, short, I guess you want to put it. She's also short compared to my first Doberman that I had, who was also a European girl. Mm-hmm. She's like a year and a half behind the growth curve compared to her. At 7 months old, she was every bit as big as my boy is now. And at 7, Dolly was nowhere near there.
Right.
Well, anyway, so my question is that do the boys go through some kind of change in appetite when the girls are in heat? Because like I said, I never seen a difference in him until this past Saturday. My boy's a chow hound. You put raw meat down in front of him, I feed him raw chicken, raw beef, and down it goes. But since Saturday, he's been on a hunger strike. Now, he ate for me Saturday night because I hand-fed him. I've never had to do that, okay? But I hand-fed him. In the meantime, I looked online to see if anybody had any suggestions, and there was like 7 different reasons why a dog may not eat, okay? He has no teeth problems. He has nothing lodged in his throat. Everything's working like it's supposed to be. He runs everything else. He doesn't seem depressed. He doesn't have no temperature. His ears aren't warm. His nose is cool. The only thing different is Dolly's in heat, and she's getting close to the time where she's receptible, okay?
Right, she's flagging.
I've always been, huh?
She's flagging him. She's flagging him.
Flagging.
Yeah. Well, from what the breeder I got her from and the other fellow that I got the other Doberman from told me that it's around day 21 to 23. And we're on, let's see.
I know what your question is.
Yeah, he's not eating. And right. I don't know why.
Because she's in heat.
I can tell you why.
Because she's in heat.
I can tell you why. So, one thing about dogs, they're not too far off from humans. Okay? When I was in high school, many years ago, if there was a pretty woman in the room at a party, two guys are not talking about what we're going to eat today. We're talking about who's going to walk up to that girl and get a phone number. We don't care. We could be hungry as hell. We don't care about food. See, what you have to understand that we're not that far off from the animal species in regards to
okay.
Once the dog comes in heat and she's ovulating, the discharge that female has is almost like crack to a male dog. It kicks off this particular hormone where that's why male stud dogs always lose weight during breeding time because they're not talking about eating. All they want is some water, and that's it.
Yeah, and that's basically, if so, is that all right? I mean, I'm worried about him not eating anything.
Oh, he'll eat. He won't starve himself. I've never seen a dog starve himself unless he's sick. He just won't hurt. Okay.
Oh, okay. I got news for him. He's not going to get her.
Yeah, you got to try to separate them.
Yeah, you're going to have to separate them.
I have been.
Okay, yeah.
Yes. Yeah, we're doing a good job of the separating. I've had five other heat cycles to get used to this.
Right. Yeah, is this the first time she's gone into heat to see that he stopped eating?
Yes. Yes, and the first time that I've noticed a different smell in her discharge, okay?
Oh. How old is she?
She's past. She's three.
Three, yeah.
How old is he? Four.
Okay, sometimes, and I don't want to get too far into it, but sometimes every male, it's different. Like I had a red male, Alonzo. In 10 months, he was ready to go. Some dogs have to figure it out. Some dogs, if the female snaps at him one time, he's like, I don't want to deal with it. So now he acts normal. Sometimes it just takes, every dog is different as far as males, how aggressive they want to be to pursue that female. You know, so he's kicking in now.
I can tell you how he's pursuing her. Will you do that again? He's laying on the other side of I got a gate up because I want to do dishes and I don't want anything going on. So he's on the other side of the gate here.
Right.
Now, come on. Sing. Of course. You want him to do something, they're camera shy.
Yeah. Yeah. Josie, I can't tell you how many times I've had shoots postponed because a female goes in the heat. And the person who owns the dog is like, oh, you know, you can't come film now. My dogs are not eating. They're all skinny, you know, or, you know, a lot changes at a home that has a female in heat, you know. Dogs have to be separated. You know, dogs that normally get along have to be separated. The males aren't eating. Females that aren't ovulating are fighting. You know, all kind of things happen. And that's very natural.
Well, okay, I only have one girl and one boy, and I never had a boy before, but the fellow that I got the first girl from when his stud died, which was my girl's daddy, he was heartbroken, so he went out and got this puppy that I ended up with because, he wanted another boy to fill that spot. You know, like you were telling earlier, I mean, I cried for months when my girl died, months. And so I wanted another girl. I waited about a year before I got this one. And I went all the way down to Hollister, Missouri, some 700 miles to go get her. And everybody thought I was crazy, but they just don't know. You get so attached to them. She sleeps with me, and he sleeps on the living room floor. Now he does, anyway. We hear this moaning and groaning at night when, oh no, she's there and there's several fences between him and me.
Right.
So Anyway, that was the question I had. Was I just concerned about his eating, and now that you're telling me this is normal, I feel very better.
Normal. Very normal. Yeah. All right. Just, you know, if he goes like 3 or 4 days and he's not eating, then yeah, just hand feed him till she's done. Right. I mean, just give him something, like, because a little bit of food is better than no food, you know. And he's probably, like I said, he's probably going to be a very small appetite till she's cleared through whatever it is. I mean, through, we know exactly what it is, right? It's just once she clears through through her heat cycle.
Right. Yeah.
All right. Thanks so much for calling.
Okay. Thanks right. very much. Bye-bye. Right,
have a great evening. Thank you. Yeah, man.
That was a good one.
That was a good one. I mean, but listen, man. Listen, you know, I can't tell you how many times a dog going in the heat mess up my week. I'm all got my camera gear all ready to go. Car keys. Might have bought a plane ticket. Might have bought filled the car with gas. I'm ready to go filming. Zeke, my female just went in the heat last night. I can't tell you the story. Oh, my male, he done ripped through the wall and they got into a fight. Or... my female went to heat, and I was my dog. I got back, and my dog hasn't eaten for 3 days. And man, it just changes things. But yeah, that's very natural. I mean, that's what, like you said, that's what happens, right?
I gave the perfect analogy, bro.
That's, yeah, exactly. We're not talking about heat. All right, we're gonna take one more call, man. I'm gonna try to. This is Ryan calling in, and then we're gonna get going to. I'm gonna let you go, and I'm gonna get ready for the next show. That's gonna be Oscar Moore at 6:30. 1 second. Ryan, how's it going, my brother?
Good. hold on.
Got an anime. You guys hear me? House. Yes, sir. How's it going?
What's going on, Ryan?
Those posters on the ceiling, man?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I have a question. Do some Dobermans like water? Because I've been taking my puppy to some kind of lake, and he hates the water. He freaks out. And I heard that Dobermans are very good at dock diving, but for some reason, he hates the water so much.
That's a good question, because, you know, with the amount of dogs I've had, some of them love water,
right,
and some of them hate water, okay? Dobermans, it's a 50-50 crapshoot, but... when you're acclimating them into a pool setting where you're getting in the pool with them to assure them that the water's fine, then they won't stay out of the pool, you know. But believe me when I tell you this, they're not great swimmers. They have to learn how to swim because they will drown. These are not Labradors.
Right.
But you would have to get into the lake with him to assure him it's okay. I got one dog that hates the water too, but he loves chasing it and biting it when I'm wetting down the backyard. So those things are training techniques where you're going to have to encourage him and show him by you doing it with him, letting him know that you're in the battle with him so he can trust you that water's fine. Until then, wow. Genetically, he's not predisposed to being a dog that chases, that retrieves.
Or even goes in the water. They're not a water breed.
Right.
True.
Right.
Yeah, that's a good point.
But it can be done.
Yeah. How's Brody doing?
You know what, Brody, man, he's... Unfortunately, he had... And it's bad to say, but unfortunately, he had hemorrhaging of the prostates.
Oh, my.
Yeah, so he was bleeding internally. I thought that he had a urinary tract infection. It wasn't. So I took him to the doctor. The doctor said, no, his bladder infection is too bad where they can't fix him. So they went and opened him up, and they said, Gerald, we got to put him down. We had to put him down. And so to confirm, because for me, I don't go by what just a vet says. I had a necropsy done. So the necropsy confirmed that he actually had hemorrhaging of the prostate, which is called internal bleeding. He was 6 years old. And he was a rock star. So with these animals, man, nothing's guaranteed. And it still hurts today because it happened overnight where one morning I woke up and he was laying in his urine and his feces. He wouldn't get up, but he looked at me and I was like, this is not right. Yeah, Brody's known for walking in his dog poop but not laying in it. And Jesus. Took him to the doctor and it just got progressively worse over a 6-hour period. And We cremated him. I got his ashes at the house. And, you know, and you just have to rebuild. I thought about folding it up after that. You know, I was like, man, wow. That happened so quick, but you're gonna be battle tested all the time. And none of these dogs are guaranteed to live 10 years, 5 years, 2 years. But I had to get a necropsy done to ease my mind on what happened to him. And unfortunately, he passed away. But he made some great puppies, though.
Now, what am I trying to say? Is it very common with Dobermans with this kind of medical problem that they have?
From what the doctor told me, it's not as common as it's not as common just with Dobermans, but with any breed. You know, he said he sees it a lot in shepherds mostly. Dobermans, he hardly ever do. But Brody was a 30-inch to the wither dog, so he was a little bit above average. He was above standard breeds. But you trust me, I've spent tens and 15s and $20,000 on Brody over the course of his life. For me to get the right proper medication and surgery, to me, it ain't nothing but a black credit card charge. That's a write-off. Couldn't get it done. And, you know, Lord makes the final decision. So, and that's why he probably hasn't been on social media for at least 3 or 4 months, because how do you explain that? You know, how do you, because it's depressing to even talk about it, because it's not like I got 10 years out of it. It's not like I got 12 years. I got 6 years out of it. And you got to start over. And it's really hard to find a male that is exactly like him. And that's the problem in this game. You would never get one that was just like him. All of them going to be different.
Yeah, I heard that it's very hard to find a Doberman nowadays. Like, in terms of, like, health-wise and stuff. But that's just me, though.
Every breed has a certain prone health issues. You got Frenchies that have breathing issues and joint problems. You got Shepherds that have hip dysplasia. You got Rottweilers that may get diabetes because they can gain weight. You got Great Danes who don't live past 8 to 9 years max. Every breed has some kind of genetic predisposed issue. But it's up to you to give them the best they can to give them a longevity of life. But again, nothing's promised with no breed.
Yeah. Oh, there he is now.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
Where you get him from? What's the dog's name?
I got him from a breeder in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. His name is Vom Hus. I can't pronounce his name, his last name, but he also breeds those European show line shepherds.
Okay.
What a name like Vom something. It sounds like he got working dobies over there.
Yeah, he actually does. He has some working Dobermans. Apparently his grandfather was kind of Pride of Russian. I heard that a lot of people don't like Pride of Russian, though.
Pride of Russia.
Yeah, Pride of Russia. Is that true?
Well, I mean, Pride of Russia's... you know, one thing you learn about this Doberman community, man, they're finicky. And they're going to talk bad about a certain kennel to promote their kennel. Pride of Russia is really just another kennel that got dogs from Del Nazi. Federer Del Nazi was a big time red Euro male that won a lot of titles, a lot of protection, IPO shows. He was a nice looking male. So Pride of Russia didn't just come up and started making their own dog. They got their dogs from Del Nazi. Del Nazi is still in business. POR still make great dogs, because the dog that set them on fire was a dog named Sador.
I think that the father is Del Nazi.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, and when when I saw him in person, he was magnificent stud, and his ears were cropped, but they were flopped down.
Yeah.
But I guess every Doberman's different.
Dogs, but again, you gotta screen the dogs that they're breeding. I like PR. I've never bought from PR. Del Nazi is great. I mean, he's been doing it. Obviously, he's doing something right. He's been in the business 15 years, if not longer. Yeah.
Well, this breeder has been breeding Dobermans for 20 years and Shepherds for 30 years. So, and, I mean,
if he's doing it that long, then he's doing something right. That's the point.
Yeah. Yeah, it's just that I heard that people say that, oh, Del Nazi and other kennels have bad reputations and et cetera.
Well, and it probably stemmed from the lack of health testing that went on 8, 9, 10 years ago when it wasn't an issue, where it wasn't important. And that's why I said at the beginning of this podcast, Zeke asked me, have the Europeans gotten better with the breeding quality? And I said, in regards to health, they have. Because at some points back in the day, they didn't even list the health test results. They list all the titles in the world, but no health. Now they're transparent with that. But again, you can have a dog for 6 years and he has a spontaneous mutation of DCM. So this is the nothing. It's something that you, when you buy a dog, when you buy a European Doberman, you have to have your mindset that something may happen. But as long as you get a dog that has one copy of DCM or no DCM copies, the likelihood of him dying from that is probably 1 in 100. He'll die from something that he choked on first.
Well, he did swallow something one time, but
tell you a little secret. I had a puppy, and see, I didn't tell you guys this. I had a puppy named Romeo. I imported him from this kennel out of France named Devil Inside. Very nice lady. She don't speak much English at all. Puppy was doing good. He swallowed a rubber stopper. You know those stoppers that go on the bottom of metal chairs to keep you from scratching the floors?
Mm-hmm.
He swallowed that. 2 days later, he's not eating. 3 days, a day after that, which is third day, he's dead.
Shit.
He wasn't even 8 months old. So, and puppies put everything in their mouth.
Yeah. Well, he ate something rubber too. But
you know, this didn't pass out properly. This didn't pass out at all. So when the doctor opened him up to remove it, his large intestines were all blue. And that means there was lack of oxygen. So he said the intestines, the lining of the intestines are super thin. So anything can happen, man.
Anything can happen. All right, Ryan, thanks a lot for the call, bro.
Yep.
Thanks
no problem.
Calling him, bro. All
right.
Yep.
All right, guys. That's going to be it for this show. I'm going to wrap it up. But I do want to speak on that puppy thing because, you know, I get a lot of folks that, you know, I don't know if they're trolling. I don't know what they're doing. But they seem to want to insist that, you know, crate training dogs, puppies is, like, inhumane. And I just...
No, you got to do that.
Man, you got to... Because you can't watch a dog 24/7, especially not a puppy.
You got to do
that. You know, I live in a house with... I have a puppy where he's almost two now, but he's been... For the last 2 years, he's been pretty much been a puppy. I got two kids. I got an 8-year-old and a 6-year-old. You know, I can't tell you all the little toys and things that kind of come around my house. I can't tell you how many times I catch my dog. You know, he knows when he's picked up something and he shouldn't have anything in his mouth because he'll look at me and he'll run in the corner. And then I got to go get it out of his mouth. But, you know, if he was left to be around the house 24/7, with great periods of times of no supervision, I can't tell you how many things he would have swallowed. I have a crate in the house. He for the most part, he doesn't spend a tremendous amount of time in there, but whenever he can't be watched or whenever no one's has an eye on him, he's in there because it's the safest place for him.
Right? And you know what? When you train him right, he wants to be in there. That's his home.
No, listen. Let me tell you a story. Like, so you haven't been to my house, but you haven't been here, right?
Yeah, I have.
Come okay, on. Okay. Yeah, so you know, I work in the backyard, right? And you have been. That's right. We did that ASMR. Come on, okay, cool.
We did that food chewing thing.
Yeah, exactly. ASMR. Yeah, exactly. So
yeah,
you know, Roscoe, we have a routine. You know, him and Bernie, they for the most part, they kind of going in and out of the house when I going out of the house, but literally. At you know, typically around 11 o'clock, I go in the house and I'm going to bed. Roscoe literally walks in the house, walks in his crate, goes to sleep. Some days I'll forget to close the crate door. You know,
he's still in there.
He's in there. But then the thing about it is, but what happens is in the middle of the night, my wife is yelling at me because she's walking to the bathroom and she bumps into the crate door because I left it because it's left wide open. So I close the crate door, not because keep him in there. I close it so that there's a clear walking path to the bathroom. Right. She don't have to, you know, so that I don't get screamed at by her. You know, but yeah, but like when you crate train a dog, I mean, it becomes a very comfortable space for them. They don't want to be in there all day, and they definitely don't want to be in if there's a lot of activity going on outside of the crate. But Roscoe, like I said, if I get up in the morning, I'm getting the kids ready for school. I let him out. I let him run around with us while they're doing that because he sees the kids. He wants to be part of that. Right, he sees my other dog, Bernie. Bernie is never in the crate because Bernie, his bed is his crate, and he's responsible. He's not running around the house finding things to chew on. He's 13 years old. He's been there, done that. You know,
right.
So you know, he comes out, but you know, when we leave the house, he goes back in the crate. I would never. You know, you never know what the dog's going to eat. Put in his mouth.
I'm telling you. It's bananas, and I have a big crate in my house too, the big wire crate, right?
Yeah, that's what a wire crate.
Right, and Casanova would sleep in there all day long, and I want him to be familiar with that because when we have guests over, and if he's not outside or if the guests are outside in the backyard, because we're going to wait in the backyard, we're done.
Yeah.
I don't want him to be a nuisance, and I don't want him to have an issue with somebody who's moving wrong or acting different.
Right.
Say something loud that triggers him.
Right.
So for me, the crate, it's hard. I read this book, man, and it was a nice paperback book. It's no more than 30 pages. And I recommend it for everybody who has a problem with crate training. Because if you have an inside dog, he has to be in a crate. And the book is called How to Housebreak a Dog in 7 Days. Now, you don't literally break him in 7 days, but it teaches you how to get them programmed, right? You only let them out to poop and eat and drink, and that's it.
Right.
You only let them out to do that. You do that for like a constant period. So now he knows, okay, when I get to go outside, I do my thing, and I come back in, and it's all good.
Right.
And so I read that 30-page book, and it worked out great for me. And I have a crate in my house no matter where.
Right.
My vacation home, I got a crate. Crib out here, I got a crate. And so, and I have it soft with his chew toys or whatever he can chew on. And it's good, man. Right. So people who, listen, my whole house is not a dog house.
Right, so I'm exactly. not going to let it
eat. And you know dogs will chew on something or do something because that's what animals do, man.
Right, exactly.
So,
well, all right, I'm a firm believer. All right. Well, Gerald, thanks so much, man, for taking the time to do this. I think we should do this again sometime. We can always switch the subject up, and I can bring you back, you know, because I'm sure there's more people out there that want to talk to you. And
I like the live questions thing, man. That was dope.
Yeah, yeah. I like this whole format, right? Like, this is solely different. There's a new there's a Michelle out this software. It's called Ecamm Live, which basically allows me to I sent you that link. It allows you to call in. It allows me to call in. Allows me to much more easily organize my desktop so that I can actually, because before I was using this other thing called OBS, and I felt like I needed someone to actually run the show because things were hidden, you know, but this, everything's right up front. I can see everything, and it's real easy to operate the show, and I enjoy doing these lives. I love having the interaction with the audience.
Shout out to Donald DJ, though. Whoever Donald DJ is, he's
doing his
down.
Thing, right? Yeah, he do his thing, man. Yeah. Listen, man, that brother show up every time. I haven't met Donald DJ. He just asked to be the moderator, and, you know, he's doing a great job doing that, man. I appreciate him. He keeps the especially with me handling on this, I kind of don't even worry about the chat. I look through the chats every now and then to put some stuff up, but yeah, he's doing this thing in the chat room. So this is a good little system. I think we should do this again, you know, sometime in the future. We can find something else to talk about Doberman related. All maybe you next time we talk protection training. All right, that's what's up, man.
Tell the people if they want to follow me on Instagram, they can do that at European_Doberman_stud.
Right. There you go. You got Facebook too, or just that's it? Just
Facebook. At Facebook page is European Doberman Stud. Website is European Doberman Stud. Listen, we can talk about dogs. We can talk about animals. I love this stuff. Can't get enough of it. I wake up thinking about it.
All right.
Other than making money.
I hear that. Well, all right, Joe, man. Thanks again, man. I appreciate you always, man. You've been a part of this documentary experience for a while. Like I said, we've done several videos. We did the ASMR video. One of the first people to come in for a live. So, you know, much appreciated, and man.
I'm happy to be a part of it, man.
All right, brother. I'll talk to you soon.
All right.
Man. All right, take it easy.
Take care.
All right, peace.
All right, bye-bye.
All right, guys, that's that for that show. Check it out, though. I'm going on a doubleheader tonight. So in about, looking at about 50 minutes. 50 minutes is my math is right. Yeah, I'm going to be on live again with Oscar Mora, and we're going to talk about dog training, dog trainers, how you can find the appropriate dog training situation for yourself. If you have a dog, you want to get some training done. You're going to talk about how it works and all that other stuff. So that's going to be popping off at 6:30 Pacific Daylight Time. All right, guys, I want to thank you so much for taking the time out. Take a break, and I'll see you guys back here in a little bit. All right? Peace.